Good afternoon and welcome once again to the 2023 IHF Coaches and Referees Education Week, where leading experts throughout the world of handball share their knowledge and experience in the 7 days that this week has. My name is Adrian Costeu. I'm a member of the IHF media team and I will be your host throughout the next week for 12 interesting webinars. Two of them are already elapsed. We had the previous one with Paul Landuret this Sunday, but now we will be heading towards another zone of handball, the referee zone, which we know it's very, very interesting. To begin with, we would like to let you know that these sessions will be in English, but we have translations available. Just look at your Zoom. On the bottom of your screen, there is the interpretation button, the globe button. You just need to click on it, and then you'll have French, Spanish, and Arabic translations. All these sessions, all these webinars fall under the umbrella of the IHF Education Center, available at ihfeducation.ihf.info, where you can also find on demand recordings of the previous webinars. Okay, in the second webinar of the day, in the 2023 IHF Coaches and Referees Education Week, we will have a webinar presented by the chairperson of the IHF Playing Rules and Referees Commission, Per Morten Sødal. The theme is the development of refereeing tendencies related to simulations and punishments. So Per Morten, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Adrian, and very much welcome to all of you. I hope you are enjoying your weekend, and we really appreciate that you are choosing to spend some time with us in this lecture, where you will also be able to ask questions, do that to Adrian, and we will try to open for questions also during the session.
If you just can, for a second, so you can ask the questions in the Q&A part of the Zoom. So that should be clear, right? So Per, please.
Yes. Use the question Q&A in Zoom, and then we'll see. Then we will see your questions. If you can show me the next slide, please. Little bit of the agenda today. We will have first a quite short introduction about where we are standing at the moment. We will look a little bit into technology we are using. Then we will go more directly into the topic of today, which is more finding the right balance between punishments and the tendency we see now with where overreactions, provocations, simulations are getting unfortunately being a little bit bigger part of our game. And then we, of course, will end with some conclusions. So I think we can start directly with the introduction chapter. If you then you can do like that, perfect. For the last 1 year, we have had three world championships, two younger age category championships for under 21 and now under 20 and under 18 girls or women in Slovenia and Northern Macedonia, and we of course also had the men's world championship in Sweden and Poland in the beginning of this year. In general, the refereeing or playing rules and refereeing commission, the PRC, which I'm the chairman of, we are quite satisfied with the performances. I think we have had very few games where the games have been out of control of the referees, and also even as important, very few games where the referees have had a clear influence on the final result. So, of course, for the handball community and then also for us, that's really, really important. For the future, we see that many of our top referees are more or less of the same age. from 42, 43 years old and to 47, 48 years old. A lot of our top referees are in this age category. Even if we are looking into raising the age limit from 50, from the existing 50 years, year old age limit, we are now also preparing for quite a change of generation also, that we expect some of the top referees to stop also after the Olympics in Paris next year. So on the biggest stage, you will see some new faces for sure in the coming years. What we are working with is kind of also to be as transparent as possible about what we are working with, to create that predictability that you come to a world championship and then you shouldn't feel that the first days you are experiencing a completely different sport, because the referees have got some guidelines and so on a course, and then suddenly the handball game becomes completely different. That's not our target. Our target is that everyone should be aware of what the criteria is. And this criteria should also be spread worldwide. So also the teams, the players are not experiencing big differences from their domestic league through their continental competitions to the IHF. Our goal is to be as similar as possible. Of course, we are humans, all of us, even if we want to be perfect, but perfection is not possible. So we will make mistakes. Mistakes will happen. But as long as the guidelines are clear, at least we are working with the fundament of the same plan, which is, of course, a key here. We have no big plans on making bigger rule changes in the next short period. No big rule changes, like for example the throw-off area, which we almost now have completed a complete season of using. And for being able to create this predictability and this transparency, we are really depending on working with coaches. Our coaches commission is a very, very important partner for us. We are cooperating on a lot of things. For example, say that when the referees are being educated about passive play before a world championship, this is not done by let's say referee experts. This is done by coaches. In the future, we are working with the pivot area, which it will be reflected that in 2 days I will have a lecture together with the coach of the Swedish national team for men, Glenn Solberg, about this topic. So it's also reflect that here we are really working together. That means also that when we are making changes, when we are making adjustments, when we are making modifications of rules or the rule interpretations, we are doing it together. It's not like the refereeing side or the rule experts are doing this completely by themselves. Here we also involve our coaches. We do, of course, have a huge knowledge and huge experience in the game to make find the solutions that are best for handball. That's really, really important for us, that also for the implementation, that we can say that this is something we are together doing, not that some group has created by itself. Also, we have created an app, the IHF Rule Interpretation app. This one we hope that will now very shortly coming to life again now. The content that's there for the moment is the new rules, but this app will also be updated with a lot of new content also in the coming months and year. In general, to be very clear about that, we are in favor of innovation and technology. But we are also in favor of doing things step by step. So we our goal is not to create a revolution tomorrow here. If we are making changes, modification, introduce new things, we will do it step by step. Can I have the next slide, please? A little bit about how we think our core, as in the teaching of the referees. What we, and if you press one more, you will have the last circle also. Of course, we want referees that are good in game management. Our sport is so complex, so if you have to take several hundred decisions every game, if you just isolate every situation and judge this isolated, it's impossible to get everyone right. Here we are looking for the big lines. For being able to have a good game management, we need referees that are strong communicators. That means they can be strict, of course. They can smile, but they can also explain what they want the players to adjust by using their personality, using clear body language, also to tell the other players, the coaches, the spectators, the hopefully many millions of TV viewers that are watching the game, why they want this to be adjusted, or also if they take a strong decision, they have to explain why they take this decision. This is also about giving players the chance and teams the chance to adjust. Here, of course, two of our core values is protecting the image of our sport. That means obeying the rules, of course. So we want to avoid, of course, mistakes that can lead to that the game have to be played once more, for example. But also, like, we want to keep the beauty in our sport. Of course, tough physical sport, really tough physical, a lot of duels, one against one situations, two against two situations, can be really physical. But we want to keep it there, and we want to keep it honest without any simulations and so on. This we really want to take away from our sport. Of course, protecting the health of the players, dangerous fouls. We have to punish dangerous fouls to prevent more dangerous fouls from occurring. And also, of course, protecting the health of and the security of the players. Really, really important. Those two circles here will be the most of the topic today. The last one is, of course, fairness and balance. That means, to say it in one sentence, more or less same situation, always the same decision. It's also one of our core values. Then you can show the next slide, please. So we want, and all referees also watching this with a dream of receiving the IHF badge or the dream of being better, then of course then the most important is how you develop and how you perform in your next match. Your next match is always the most important one, no matter what kind of match it is. It's the most important one because it's the next match. We want to see referees that have a personality, that have the possibility or the ability to communicate and then be understandable and then kind of be leader for, even if you have two teams, to keep the game as one team inside the frame we the handball sport want to have the games in. We have to obtain same criteria for punishment. We'll get back to that. It has not been a big changes here in the last years, and I don't expect it to be to change a lot also in the years to come. What we are discussing a lot is the balance between the attack and defense, that we may be creating a game now where we maybe are giving too many advantages to the attackers, and that we don't have the ability to give credit for good and honest work in defense. We are looking into this now. For example, a big focus point in the time to come will be step violations. Pivot play is a continuously topic among in our world championships, and for sure also in continental and national competitions, for sure, where we also have to look a little bit more on what the pivot is doing. That sometimes it's so easy, so safe to whistle this 7 meter or giving this suspension to the defender because we are used to it. Everyone expects it in a way. But here, a lot of things are really starting with violations from the pivot also. So in the future, we don't want any revolution, but we really want the referees to observe what is the first foul, what is the first violation. If that is a violation from the pivot, we want an offensive foul, for example. Adrian, do you have some questions before we go to the next sub-chapter?
There are no questions from our participants, so we can go to the next chapter and see what's going on there.
Yeah, okay. Either I'm very clear or I'm clear as the fog. I don't know. Maybe the
no, I think you're quite clear. I think you've been quite clear until now. So everybody understands what the referees need to do. Let's see some situations now.
Yeah, we are soon coming to the situations. We're just going a little bit into the technology we are using. We are using the VR. You can show the next slide. We are using the VR. Not the VAR, and we have now also introduced a three referee system. If you look at the picture, you have a referee from Switzerland in the middle, the really smiling referees as usual, Bojan Lah from Slovenia, and also the smiling one to the right is from Argentina. This we tested in the Super Globe for men last year. Of course, when we're doing so, this is a huge change. This is a revolution for the referees. It's not a revolution for the game, but it's a revolution for the referees. And this felt very strange when we introduced it, but they had a few minutes whistling a training match in these trios, and they felt it right away that this was something. This is something positive. This is something that might be our future, but we will take it step by step. This system is not—it's not finished in the creation. We have to think a little bit more about some issues, solve some challenges, and also here we need a smooth transition. I guess that after the Olympics next year, we will test it in more events. But it's not, it's the three referee system. It's nothing that will come like this. And we are also aware that this is a system for top sport. In many countries, including my own in Norway, we have, it's challenging sometimes. only to have one referee in a younger age category match. So here, I think the future might be a one referee, that some games will have one referee, some games will have two referees, probably most games, and some games will have three referees. Next slide. Then we are coming to the video replay, the VR. And here, of course, a lot of us are watching a lot of football. There they have the VAR. We have no A. This means that the referees themselves are the one that are taking the decision if they want to look at the video or not. Sometimes the match delegate can do the same if it's a case of faulty substitution or too many players on the field. On the court. But in general, the referees decide themselves if they want to watch the video. And we have no plans of having a video assistant. We have no plans of having a person connected to the referees telling them, no, now you should go and watch the video. This will not happen in the next short period, for sure. Very important also for the nations and the referees that are using the VR in their competitions and also, of course, in continental competitions. The VR should not be used for confirming a decision. If you are 98% sure that it's a two-minute suspension, then give the two-minute suspension. Not go and check to make 98%, 100%. It's not for this. This will create a lot of interruptions in the game, and it will make then the game flow will be completely different. The dynamic of the game will be completely different, and we will have a different sport. The criteria for the referees is serious doubt. And then we also have a protocol to follow, and we have some clear points of what kind of situations can be looked on. If we look too often, then we create an expectation in the handball community, players, coaches, spectators, media, that we should look on every situation where we are taking a tough decision. That's not the idea behind this. We have some new points that we are testing it in some, for example, the shot in the head during an open play situation, for example, which is not in the regulations that are used in the World Championship now. Some nations are testing that, and we might look into some other situations, but here also not a plan for big changes. For the Men's World Championship, 112 games, we had 83 checks and an average time of the check on 72 seconds. Which is, in our view, quite efficient. That means from the time is stopped until the game is restarted again, 72 seconds in average. We also see that we have more than 90% of the decisions are correct after using VR. Here we can see a short example, if you just play the video now, short example of use of VR. I think both you and the referees are in the same situation where you are not able to see what was really happening here. It's an arm to the face, but it's really not a hit. It's an arm. The defender is responsible, The fan behind here is probably not the best referee. He's probably not neutral either, since it's the home team here. And the decision with a 2 minute suspension is fully okay, of course. But this is kind of a situation. If you see this, and you should see it, then this is not a situation for VAR. Here, the referee should decide a direct 2 minute suspension right away without doing the VAR. You can show the next slide. Like here, decision is okay, but here, no need to use the VAR. Next one, more complicated situation from the semifinal of the Men's World Championship. Player up in the air receives a not hard push. We can see it from a lot of angles. Up in the air, ball is on the right side of the attacking player. The push comes from the left side. If this push is coming on the wrong moment, when he's about to shoot, he's very vulnerable. That means it's very easy to lose body balance and complete lose body control, as he's doing here. Therefore, even if you don't have the best angle here, and this one is more difficult for the referees, we can see that referees are using more time. In one, the big video here, that's the videos they are looking at. Here, back again, player in the air, there is the contact push, and we have a total loss of body control. Looking again, this one is difficult. If we just go to the next slide here, this is that situation where here it's given a red card, but we can also here, which we accept. Can accept our red card here because it's a push. It's far away from the ball. The timing is bad. It causes a total loss of body control. Therefore, the player is shown the red card. But here also, we can say that the push is not really strong. Maybe the effect of the situation is a little bit more than really it's natural based on the push. So we will not say that a 2 minute suspension is completely wrong either. So sometimes we also have to say we have to accept both decisions. If you show the next slide. And here you see that the effect is really, now we are starting to speak about the effect. And if we then continue, I think we can, if you don't have any questions, Adrian, we can start to go into the effect criterion.
Yeah, we have some questions. The first one, okay. It relates to the three referees situation. Is it a better situation to have six pair of eyes than four pair of eyes? How did this experiment was born, and what do you think about the future of this this situation with three referees for a match?
Yeah, six eyes or three pairs of eyes should see more and better than four eyes or two pairs of eyes. Clear. We see that we have some. The pivot area is very demanding. It's demanding to see what is happening between the players. Therefore, we really encourage also with a referee pairing system that the referees are wider when they are court referees, so they are able to see between the players. And we see also that in some breakthrough situations, the goal line referee might be a little bit overloaded with tasks if he or she should both watch the pivot area and the breakthrough situation. Therefore, we kind of can divide the tasks a little bit more when we have three, and we are also creating some angles that are that might be preferable. So that's the idea, to see more, of course, and get more correct decisions.
And another question refers to VR. Is there a plan to also let the teams choose when to use a VR analysis, or only it will stay to the referees?
It's a good question, which is a little bit difficult to answer. Because the handball community for sure know that the European Handball Federation are now testing the coaches' challenge in their final fours. We are not against a kind of a technology or innovation like the coaches' challenge. We are absolutely not against. What we need to make sure when we implement things like this is that we have a very clear protocol, which cannot be used for tactical reasons, and that is clear for everyone when it can be used, in what kind of situations it can be used, and what's the consequence of a successful challenge. This is of course clear that the decision is changed. But also, what's the consequence of an unsuccessful challenge? Here we need, in the IHF, we need a little bit more time to see how we can implement this in the most fair way, if we implement it.
One other question relates to the three referee system. How does each referee manage the tasks in the game? So, of course, there is a different situation than in a pair, with the referees knowing each other very well and knowing how to divide their tasks. So what's the answer to this question?
Yeah, one of the things with the three referee system is that it's quite flexible. That means we can have The basic here is that we have a goal line referee as usual, because we have to have a referee that are checking the goal area and a referee that are checking if we have if the ball is inside the goal or not. The court referee in a basic position is still a court referee, but he's more central. We don't have so much a diagonal anymore, more central. Maybe also slightly over to the side of the goal line referee. Then we have what we have called a side referee. Basic position, sideline, 9 meters. But that's just a basic position. Here you can see what's happening between the defenders and the attackers. You have perfect position for seeing that. But in certain situations, for example, in one of the games in Superglobe, one of the teams played 7-6 with 3 pivots. Then the referee trio in that match chose to have 2 goal line referees and 1 court referee. They felt that that position was the best to solve that challenge. But we can also have a system where we have a goal line referee and 2 court referees. So this position of the new referee, this side referee, is very, very flexible. And this also demands that the referees understand the game, the tactical situation in the game, and position themselves accordingly.
Thank you, Per. You can proceed now.
Okay, thank you. But that three really good questions. I'm sure that the questions also were better than the answers, but I'm doing the best I can. We can go a little bit further with the next slide. The general criteria for punishment, this is written in Rule 8.3. for those of you that are familiar with the rule book. The referees are judging especially four different things, four different criteria when they are considering giving punishments. It's the position of the player who makes the violation. That means, to say it easy, front, from the side, from behind. Of course, in general, a violation from behind is more serious than a violation from the front, but a violation from the front can also be really, really serious, can be, in theory, a red and blue card if some of the other criteria are really, really strong. Second criteria, part of the body being fouled. Of course, receiving a hard hit in the face is a lot more serious than receiving a hard hit in the body, for example. Holding a player is usually not so dangerous as grabbing the shooting arm, especially if you come from behind. The dynamics in the situation is this, more or less the speed, the intensity. And now we are not only speaking about intensity of the foul, how hard you push, how hard you hit. It might also be the speed of the player being hit. Because counterattack, for example, if the attacker is running, bouncing the ball, picking up the ball, jumping up in the air, ready to shoot. When he's in the act of shooting, he receives a small push from behind. That might be enough for a total loss of body control. So even a small foul, when it comes to the strength of the foul, might be a big foul with huge effect, which is the last criteria for punishment, with a huge effect if it happens on the wrong time. But then the effect, and we can understand that sometimes, I really understand that coaches, players feel that we are making decisions based on the effect. Therefore, fall a little bit extra violent, pretend that you are being hit in a different part of the body that you are being hit, or hit in the chest, and some pretend that they are hitting in the face, for example, because it's more serious being hit in the face. It might warrant a stricter punishment. So, to be very clear, and then we can change the slide. The next slide. The effect criteria must be explainable based on at least one of the other three criteria. We cannot just see a big effect and have without seeing what has really happened. That we just see hear a big bang and a player fall to the ground with total loss of body control. That is not enough to give a punishment. It might be that it's maybe the attacker is jumping half a meter from the defender who is just standing still, or jumping straight up, not approaching him at all, jumping straight up. Being here, then you have a natural collision because the attacker is moving towards the defender and the attacker then completely losing body control and fall down. That's an offensive foul. It's still an offensive foul, even if the effect looked like something bad must have happened, that for sure it must be a red card. No, it's still an offensive foul. We must have other criteria. We must see that the position, small foul from behind, we can have a huge effect, explainable, or hit, for example, to the face, part of the body. It's explainable, or really the dynamic in the situation is really, really big, and it's a foul from the defender, or from sometimes also from the attacker. because we also must remember that attackers should be punished. The attackers should not be allowed to do more against the defenders than the defenders allowed to do against the attackers. So here also, we really need to have position and focus to see this. Some factors here, strength of the tackle, the dynamic. Look at the distance between the players. How is this distance closed? Is it a defender that are moving towards the attacker with great speed and then push with great speed? Of course, then we have big, big, big dynamics. Or is it just that the defender is in correct position, standing more or less still and being jumped into by the attacker who has taken too little distance to the defender? Then still offensive foul. So here we really need to have the focus. Also, first point of contact. Is it contact when the player is on the ground, or is it a contact first when the player is in the air? The timing of the tackle. And then is it contact on the ground, and then suddenly the attacker is sliding away from the defender who is not able to move the feet fast enough? Then does the defender just let the attacker go? Or does the defender then compensate for this by pushing? Also, this the referees need to observe, because it's essential in the decision-making. And when we come to direct 2 minutes versus a red card, the effect, partial loss of body control versus a complete loss of body control. That's one of the lead criteria for a red card, complete loss of body control. Here we also have endangering the health of the player, and also a little bit about the if it's a really reckless attitude shown by the player making the violation. Next slide, which is a video. And here we can watch this video. And then we remember this one also when we're watching the next one. Here we see the contact is when the player is on the ground, and then the player, the defender, just let the attacker go. The attacker here, in our opinion, are making too much out of it. You can play the video once more if you are able. Contact on the ground, player up in the air, throwing himself to the left. Not much of a foul here. For sure, not a foul for a 2 minute suspension here. Maybe this contact is enough for a free throw, and then whistle at free throw and also tell the attacker, hey, we don't need help. Get up. If you then can choose and go to the next slide, you can see a little bit of our conclusions about this situation. Next slide, please. There, yeah. Okay, slightly frontal. Okay, we can now choose the... you are jumping a little bit for me, but that's okay. You can choose... we can now look at this one. Now, before you start playing, okay, look at the contact here. It's different. Here still, we have a contact where the player is on the ground. But here, in the previous example, the defender then just let him go. Here, still more contact. Arms getting stiffer and stiffer and stiffer. And that means we have a push, real push. Of course, maybe not a situation for a direct red card, but still a clear situation for a direct 2 minute suspension. Again, we see the difference between those two situations. Point of the first contact is more or less at the same, with the same timing, while the first defender is letting then the player go. The second defender then compensate for not being able to move the legs quick enough, and then just pushes it. Two different situations. Yep, we can show the next slide when this video is over. Yep. the dynamic here says, or and the other criteria also says, this should be a partial loss of body control, therefore a direct 2-minute suspension, not a total loss of body control, which requires a red card. Very important for the referees, having a good angle to see what's happening between the attacker and defender here, and also court referees, keep the eye in the situation. You have a partner at the goal line who can see if the ball goes into the goal or not. Watching the ball go from A to B is not interesting. Much more important to keep your eye in the situation until it's clear. Position and focus, then you are prepared for making a correct evaluation of the situation. Next. But sometimes also the effect might be very natural. Even if usually holdings are not a direct red card, usually not. A holding is then maximum a direct 2-minute suspension. But here we see really it's not a hold, it's a pull. It causes a complete loss of body control. It is a completely reckless challenge. It has nothing to do with playing the ball. The dynamic is big, comes from behind. So here, this is, of course, if it's big effect, the big effect is natural. This should be a direct red card. Next. Yeah. You can go to the next video. But here we see a player who remains on his feet. If we say that the fact that he is remaining on his feet is enough not to punish this situation where it's an action from the side with quite high dynamic, is running into the player from the side. If we say that this should not be a direct 2-minute suspension because the player is standing on his feet after the action, then we say, then we invite overreactions, simulations. We don't want it. Even if the player, if the dynamic and the other criteria in the situation is big enough, even if we don't have the big effect, then we must punish. Because we cannot say you have to fall for being punished, because then, yeah, again, we are inviting overreactions and simulations and provocations. Next one. Of course, here should be 7 meter and a direct 2-minute suspension. Same here. We go to the next slide. The same here. We have a push from the side. Also, the ball is on the right side of the attacker. The push comes from the left side, far away from the ball. It's quite high dynamic in the push. Even if the defender, no attacker here, remains on her feet, this is a direct 2-minute suspension. Here we have enough dynamic. The position is from the side. even if we don't have the effect, those two criteria makes this a suspension. Now we will see the big, big, big effect. If you play this on good.
Den smalt ordentlig. Venemyr på vei ut, skaller direkte der med Mathias Larsson. Fysioterapeuten holdt på bak benken med Fredrik Børm. Er Dizzy selv. Kommer den. Ja, den dytten av Victor Norberg der også. Ja. Den er ferdig. Han ble dyttet. Ja, det hode klink I Mathias Larsson. Ser det unggutten som akkurat har kommet inn.
Det en... Jeg ser dytten der fra Victor Norberg, da, som sender den rett ut I ansiktet på han.
Ja. Får en smell I hodet der, og han Venemyr må rett ut igjen da. Og blør. Og Larsson må også ta telling. Fra før ligger Fredrik Børm med en skadet ankel bak der. Det må teipes og ordnes. ØIF-benken ser nå ut som et sånn lasarett. Det ser ut som et feltsykehus.
Yes. Just a small message to the guy, my friend that's running the videos. Before you start every video, can you please turn off the sound except on one, and I will tell you which video. So I can comment a little bit during. You can just show the next slide, please. Here it's a defender pushing an attacker from behind, quite high dynamics, into another player. When you do something as reckless as this, you are the defender is by himself responsible for the effect. The effect here is, yeah, it's huge. It's not nice to see pictures like this. It's a particularly dangerous situation. That, and when we speak about particularly dangerous, we are then speaking about a red and blue card. Because here, the effect becomes particularly dangerous. If the effect here, you can do the same violation, the same push, and this is ending in a situation that is endangering the health of the attacker, or a situation that causes a complete loss of other control, we have a red card. Or if it causes a partial loss of body control, we have a two-minute suspension. So here, the defender himself, in this case, is responsible for the effect. Next slide. Before we start then with the simulations, do we have some questions, Adrian?
Yes, there is a question. How to identify a total loss of body control and a partial loss of body control? That's one question we got.
Good question. A little bit basic. We can in some cases is the player able to land on his feet before he's falling, or is it just a crash landing where he or she is landing on the back or something? That might so is that if the attacker is not able, or the player being fouled is not able to protect him or herself in any way, then we have a complete loss of body control. Let's say, for example, you are pushed, landing on the feet before you fall, then we have a partial loss of body control.
And there is another question which says, it's a message basically, I completely agree that no fall on the ground is needed to a 7-meter throw and the punishment, but rules say if an attacking player retains full control of ball and body despite the violation, as in rule 15.1a, there is no reason to give a 7-meter throw, even if thereafter the player fails to utilize the clear goal scoring chance. So it's in regards with the situation, I think, in the Serbia game, right?
Yeah, or the Serbia or the Croatia Angola game. It's the Serbia game. There we have a goal, so there that's not valid, so much valid. But in the Croatia Angola game with the wing situation, it's clearly valid. But here, you don't have to fall to have a loss of body control. Here, the collision itself creates kind of you are losing body balance, and therefore here you are losing body balance, you are losing the possibility to have a normal shot, and you are also losing angle. Here, of course, the angle was clearly reduced. That means we have clearly enough criteria to whistle a 7-meter, clear chance of scoring, and a clear loss of body balance.
Perfect. Per, you can proceed with the simulations part of your presentation.
Okay, then we are going into something that is it's not new, but we are starting to having a bit of or a bit more focus on this now, because unfortunately we are seeing more and more. And also, I should have said this in the beginning. We are never giving guidelines based on teams or individuals, players, coaches. We are giving guidelines based on different topics. Of course, to show a video there, it must be some on the video. But we have no special guidelines for any teams or any players. This is general. So who, which team, which player who is shown here has zero importance. The most important is the content, and that's it. But we see, the honesty and respect, it's kind of the beauty of our sport. When my friends who don't know so much about handball, I'd say also some of the referees, my friends, I don't know so much about handball. That was a little bit of an internal joke, but still. When people that don't know handball speak about handball, yeah, very honest, not so much simulations, not so much protesting against referees and so on. We want to keep it that way. And for keeping it that way, we have to do something now because we see this tendency. But it's not only the responsibility of the referees. This is the responsibility of the clubs, national federations, coaches, and the players themselves. Here, we also have to be one team to make our sport remain as honest as we want. That's really a key for our image. We see, unfortunately, that more and more are getting very aware of the effect criterion. That means they are trying to make the effect bigger than it naturally should have been based on the situation and based on the other criteria we have gone through. Unfortunately, we also have to give coaches, players right when we say that sometimes the referees are taking this decision only based on the effect. Therefore, unfortunately, you get credit for making a bigger effect. This we totally want to stop. Now in the next part here, we will have, go back, please. We will have three different terms. We have a simulation, that means no or very little contact, or that you simulate that the contact is to a more serious part of the body than the contact really was. The second term is overreaction. That means making more or less making a too big of an effect out of the contact. The third one is the provocation. The provocation is more from the defending side. Means, for example, a wing defender running out, trying, best case, winning the ball in front of us in the side back on his, or the half back on his side. But instead cannot reach the ball, but instead running into the attacker and then throwing him or herself backwards for final provoking or making the referees whistle an offensive foul. That is what we mean with a provocation. Then you can change slides. This last part, the provocations, the referees have been quite good in punishing this. Of course, we still see situations. We also see some punishments that are for provocations that are really not provocations. But for punishing the defenders, we are clearly better than punishing overreactions and simulations from the attackers. That means we have to have focus on this now. Very, very important also, all referees and all coaches, all players that are listening to this. It's not like now we should go out and punish everything. These are clear situations. We should not look for small mosquitoes, and maybe he made the effect 1 or 2% more. No, this is not what we are looking for. But we are looking for an awareness about this, and then a positioning and a focus that we are prepared that things like this can happen. So it's not normal to have a suspension in a game for our reaction or a simulation. It's not normal. It's not like now we should have one in every game, or we should have in some games we should have 10. Yeah, maybe if it's 10, then it's 10. But don't look for it. Be prepared that it can happen, but don't search it. Don't search it. Okay, next. Some indicators that the effect is, or the reaction is really delayed. I'm hit, and then suddenly goes off a second, and then the fall comes. That the hands are held to more serious parts of the body, like I'm hit in the chest up here, and then I'm holding myself to the face. Rolling and screaming, so vocal, trying to strengthen the effect by using the voice, for example, and then in particular making clear communication to the referees that, hey, this you have to punish. Some indicators. Be prepared. Again, don't search for it. Next. Then we come to the criteria for how we should, for the punishment part of this, and how we should how we should treat this. If you have a provocation or an overreaction, if it's not really, really clear one, that we are really in the, really close to a simulation, then strong body language, You can also use a yellow card or a progressive punishment, but then don't make the card or the two fingers be the stars. Your body language, your personality, your explanation of why you are giving this decision should be the star. This should be clear. Big body language, don't need to be aggressive, don't be angry. Big, clear body language, preferably also towards the bench, show it one time, slow and communicate outside your body. Then your shoulders are going down, your chest is going forward, you also look certain, you sell the decision so much better. If you have repeated provocations and or overreactions, or we have simulations, very clear situation, no contact, you are throwing yourself to the ground, then direct 2-minute suspension. You will have the full support from myself and the IHF. Clear ones, don't search them, but prepare yourself. This can happen, and take the clear ones. This is a little bit new. Other sports have it. For example, ice hockey has this rule that even if it's a foul from, let's say, a defending player, which requires as a punishment, if you have a clear overreaction or a simulation, let's say you are hit hard in the chest, really hard in the chest, and then you're holding yourself to the face. Then, of course, 2-minute suspension for the player who was hitting you in the chest. But then you should also receive a 2-minute suspension for simulation because you were not hit in the head at all. Also, referees, if you are in doubt, if it's a provocation or an overreaction, okay, don't give this punishment. Don't whistle this offensive foul. We accept it. But then next time, make sure you are in a position with a focus so you can really be sure what this really is. In our competitions, video replay can also be used for detecting simulations. That is part of our protocol. Now it will come a quite long video. I will not comment. It speaks for itself. Here, the sound should be on. I think you can just play the video, look at it. It speaks for itself. Thank you. Yeah, you can change slide. Here it's of course so many situations. Yeah, some might be also for punishment for the defenders, but here we have several overreactions. What's the essential here is that the referees, they, when they see this, stop it right away. Tell them, stop these overreactions. If they continue, then punish. And clear also here situations which are close to simulations. That can where a 2 minute suspension for one of the attacking players have been really, really proper. These images we don't want to see. Of course, it's not nice, but also to address a little bit of the challenge, we have to show it. But here, referees must stop this immediately. You can skip this one. You can skip the next this slide and the next slide. You can just skip. Yep. Again, take off the sound. Perfect. You can play it. Big effect. Do we have anything that explains such a big effect? We have a hand quite high, shoulder, but we have no hard hit to the throat. Also, simulation here, ball should go in favor of the defenders and the attacker should be punished. Very difficult to see, but be prepared, be in position so you see in between the players and keep your eyes in the situation until it is clear. Next slide. So here, yeah, it's a small touch. If you think it's a foul, the attackers can still keep the ball. If we don't think it's a foul, the defender should have the ball, but here the referees will have our full support of in punishing such a situation. Next. Sometimes you also see some tricks. The role of the pivot player here is nothing for this this presentation. This is more for the presentation on Tuesday together with Glenn Solberg. Now you probably have seen a little bit. If you see the arm block of the attacker, if you play it once more. Now look at the left hand or left arm of the attacker. Especially when we now have the replay. She is blocking the right hand of the right arm of the defender. And then if you show the next slide, I've just taken one back. There, I've taken two still pictures out, made two still pictures out of it. The one to the left, we see that the arm is blocked. She's using, the attacker is using her left hand to block the right hand of the defender. Then the right hand of the defender is dragged up by the left hand of the attacker, up in a position where it is in a position where, yeah, if the original hit is here, it's a clear, at least direct human suspension. Depends on the dynamic of the situation. But here also, the attacker is really helping to create this situation. Also, can look a little bit of the block, quite wide legs on the pivot here, so it might also be an illegal block, but that's not the topic here. But be prepared. Good angle, good focus, so we can spot this. Next slide, please. Like I said, here, this should not be a 2-minute suspension of the defending player. You can show this video, and here we see that this is not only a non-European problem or challenge. Big, big effect. Big fall. See, first left hand to the throat. Yes, it's a hit. And then clear overreaction. This is an example of a situation where we say that you can punish both. Yeah, this yellow player number 32. Is guilty of hitting the throat of the opponent. But the attacking player here, he doesn't need to fall this way. It's too much. So here we free throw for the attacking team, 2-minute suspension for the defending player for hitting the throat of the attacker, and 2-minute suspension of the attacker for clear overreaction simulation of an effect that's simply not there based on the hit, based on the foul. Yep, next slide, please. So even if a punishment against the defender is given, the referees are fully entitled also to give a suspension to the attacker for trying to mislead them to give a more severe punishment. Your cooperation is the key here. So you have four eyes, you are one referee with four eyes. And sometimes, maybe in the future, we are a team with six eyes. We will see what's happening in the future. Yes, you can go to the next slide. Adrian, we can take some questions now before the final remarks. And when I make remarks, also think if
I think you've answered all the questions that were in this part. So with the examples we had, I think everything is quite good, because there were questions like the last action with Norway versus Sweden. I think those were questions that were answered in this situation with the attacker also being awarded the suspension.
Okay, then I repeat myself and say next slide, please. Just to sum up, we really need to take care so we involve all the criteria for punishment in our assessment of if a situation should be a punishment or not. The effect cannot be the only criteria. Then we are inviting situations, scenes like those we have shown now for the last 15 minutes. This we don't want. Positioning and focus is key. Court referees, be very careful having a position directly behind the player with the ball. Often it's better to be a bit wider out on the sideline. And then move a little bit back and forth in this position. You have, in some situations, it might be longer to the actual impact. But then when the ball moves in front of your partner, in front of the goal line referee, then you can move after the ball. But when the ball is on your side, try to stay a little bit wider or stay a little bit more central. instead of moving with the ball all the time, where the ball is on your side as a court referee, try to move in opposite direction of the ball. Then you will create different angles. In many situations, you will create better angles. Also, goal line referee, this is not a position just standing like a castle guard, standing still for the entire attack. No, move, so you can see what's happening between the players, what's happening between the pivots, what's happening close to you, close to the 6 meter line. Move so you can see it. But don't move for move, but moving to get better angles, better positions. And also be prepared. You're taking better decisions while standing still than running. If you're running full speed, your picture will be completely different than if you are standing still. In the referees, you can take strong positions. And for being able to do that, also you need support from your from your clubs, regions, national federations, continental federations, and when you are taking strong, correct decisions, you will for sure also have the support from the IHF. Then the next on the next slide now, it says thank you. I will again, John, do you have any questions? We have some minutes to answer this.
There are no other questions from what I've seen. Of course, your presentation has been very exhaustive and very, very good. It was excellent, excellently structured and with very, very good examples. So I think everything was set. I didn't see any questions right now. Everybody's is thanking you for the presentation. So I think we will conclude this webinar also here. Per, thank you very much for all the presentations and for all the explanations we had. I think we shed a light with these examples on every possible situation we can have in handball. Of course, some other new may arise, but I think from now on, I think it's quite good. So thank you, Per.
Thank you, and thank you for listening to me, and thank you for your help, both with the questions and with running the presentation with a stronger internet connection than I have at the moment.
Thank you, Per, once again. So tomorrow, 13 CEST, will have a webinar with Jordi Rivera. And at 15 CEST, the IHF 2023 Education and Referees and Coaching Education Week will continue with a lecture from Marco Scibilla. So thank you very much and see you tomorrow here.